the only way that blacks is really going to get a piece of the action is, I feel, is to do it themselves, or to produce, or to put up the money to produce. Let's say that I don't feel that blacks would feel so bad about getting involved if they had a piece of the action. I have known quite a few local producers here in the Dallas area that has gone are producing black films, and they are wondering, you know, what blacks really want to see.
Solo Song for Doc was one of the many books that we would be reading to adapt into television shows, because Ossie had studied. We were studying now television. How do black people get on television? You know, we chose James Element first because that's when Ossie and I, this stunning journey to doing with Ossie and Ruby for public television. And it was most astonishing and satisfying thing we've ever done in the arts for three seasons. They let us do whatever we liked in a railroad station in Dallas, because that's where the whole series came from, and that's where Bill McGhee came from. And I hadn't had the experience of working much with actors out of New York. You know, I wasn't. So it was exciting to me to meet. To work in a whole different setting with a whole a different group of people who weren't from New York and Philadelphia, you understand? And that had another flavor to what added something a little closer to what I thought of as a reality to being in that situation as a waiter. In those days, I sound like, well, you know what I mean. But it was those days because it was before the union, and it was the characters that Bill McGhee played, that the story was all about, and that James Allen McPherson, the author, wrote about so sensitively. I loved, you know, Bill McGhee in it. He was just. I couldn't imagine a better characterization of the working man, of the working black man at that time, than Bill McGhee. It was elegant servitude, you know what I'm saying?
I can be a waiter anywhere.
But the black waiters don't. The whites is taking over the service in the good places. And when they run you off here, you won't have no place to go.
They won't run me off. As long as I give good service, they can't touch me.
Pure goddamn fool. You're a nigger and you ain't got no rights. Except what the union says you has. And that ain't worth a damn. Because when the commissary finally gets you, they won't lift a finger to help you.
Leave off him. If anybody should be put off, it's you. Your back ain't been straight for 30 years. Making me the crackers sick. The way you keep bowing and folding your hands and saying, thank you, Mr. Boss. 50 years ago, that would have gotten you a bigger tip. But now that ain't worth a damn.
It's the trouble with the Negro waiter today. He ain't got no humility.
You know, most by watching him on set and talking to him between scenes, and that he was an actor. And I respected that so much because I don't think he was much like that character that he played, because this was one of those people that was typical of the era. You had a job like that because it was the only kind of job you could get, and it was typical, and there was a formula to being a black servant and making a living at it and not going crazy. You know, understand? And by and by, you get used to it. And that's what I thought Bill McGhee played so well.
I feel bad for you, Doc. But we all are going to get it in the end. The railroad way it is doomed. Oh, I could have told you about the lemon, but he would have gotten you on something else. So it wasn't no use, any of it.
Shut the hell up, fool! The one thing that really hurts is that a crawling son of a bitch like you will be riding the roads while all the good men are gone. Dummies like you will be working their asses off reading that damn Bible and never know a goddamn thing about being a waiter. That hurts. That hurts like hell.
But it ain't my fault because the colored waiters don't. It's your fault for letting go your humility. Letting the whites take over the good jobs.
In coming to James Allen McPherson and Bill McGhee, and all the people that I know in this life that have been meaningful to me. I can't tell you how great it is to work with actors that you sense know what they're doing and have a sensitivity not only to what the role itself is saying, but how it fits in the total social and racial and economic picture of the piece that the author has written about, a particular kind of behavior, who understands that, who understands just the degree of servitude that it took to make a living and not kill yourself. Also, you come to people like actors, like a Bill McGhee, who you're not aware of the young people that come along because you don't interact with them as much, except when after you get to be an actor. But who you come from a set of circumstances and a set of people that you don't have to explain about your father. You don't have to explain about where you come from. You don't have to explain about A. Philip Randolph and the Port Pullman and the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. Because who doesn't know about the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters? You know, one of the first unions in Black America. And that's where Bill McGhee, and I said, we've seen this man before. And as we watched some of the rushes, it was amazing. But I had the experience before, appreciating how life, the times, come through us as individuals. We become the storytellers, whether we write it or act it or understand it. And that's what Bill McGhee personified. He was an actor. We didn't talk. We didn't know each other before. But he knew as much as I knew, and he knew as much about my father as I knew, because he was doing a part that mirrored him. And that's what was so fascinating about our working with people like Bill McGhee, and they're all over the world. Somehow he became A. Philip Randolph. He understood what was happening. It was such a human story. It made me cry when I watched it lately. You know, I couldn't. And Bill's part as becoming, you understand the spectrum. You understand the zone of human relationships to each other. It's never the part of the simplistic waiter that McGhee played. He's more than, he understands what's not a simplistic waiter. And he has a line in the piece that he says, when he talks about being, he talks about one waiter who happens to be Aussie. He just doesn't know how to be humble. He has no humility. You understand? That's what it takes to be a waiter. So, it was the beginning of it's more than talking about it. It's we understand things because part of us is that already. Oh, I couldn't sympathize with you. I couldn't, You understand? Something in me has to understand slavery to turn another human being into a slave. And that's what I think what Bill McGhee contributed to Solo Song for Doc. And as I watched him, I'm thinking, you know, and he, the man, the actor himself, is no part of that. But I saw it in him. By the time I got to Bill McGhee in that film, and also James Allen McPherson and the story, that was another college course. You understand what I'm saying? Into human nature. In order to be, some of you is the emancipator, understands the slave because he also. Some aspect of him is also slave. We are each other to such a profound degree, and that's what actors like Bill McGhee can show us. We're not on opposite sides. We're just looking from different spots at different times in our existence.
You know, it's interesting having known your father and the relationship that we had and how God seemed to have just put this thing together. And your mother, they were like family, and they brought me in like family.
I met Bill McGhee. I went to audition for a film produced by Larry Buchanan called High Yellow, and I was cast in this film. I was very excited, and I had the honor of meeting and working with Mr. Bill McGhee.
You were right the first time.
Why not? Nobody will ever know the difference.
Cynthia.
I'm Joseph, but everybody calls me Joe.
My first remembrance of Bill McGhee was a number of years ago. It was probably in the 50s. I think it was the 50s still. They were doing a play, Emperor Jones. He just got to be kind of like a big brother to me because he was in the industry, he knew a lot about it. And I wrote an article about him. In fact, I still have the magazine. There was a new black magazine that came out called Black Bazaar. And I said, oh, I know who I'm going to interview. So he had just done a film, I can't remember the name of it, but it was about a biracial woman.
The year that I did High Yellow was a particularly rough year for me. I had lost my mother, my grandmother, and John F. Kennedy had been assassinated. So it was a hard year. Working on the set of High Yellow was every day was full of laughter and fun. It was a marvelous, marvelous opportunity to portray Cindy. But Bill, he was like the sunshine of that time. He was so kind and so warm. No human being could be as kind and as warm as Bill was to me.
Yeah. Now you've met them all. Did you think they'd all be angels?
I really hadn't thought much about it.
But it's not just this house. It's the same all over. Knock on any door.
When we first drove up to this house, I thought, how beautiful. I thought I could learn so much.
Yeah.
Joseph?
Yeah.
How do you stand it?
I'm just biding my time. Man can take a lot when he's got a plan.
A plan?
I'm going back to what I'm good at. Cars.
I like cars. Gonna open my own shade tree garage. I like to hear a car purr right. When a car's got a call, I know just the right medicine.
Won't that take a lot of money?
Penny.
You saving for it?
Oh, children's wages. You kidding?
Then where will you get the money?
You're looking at it.
Why are you telling me this? I could stop you.
You won't, honey. You won't. Two reasons. First, because of who you are and what you are. But mainly because you got a plan, too.
Oh, I don't.
You got a plan, don't you, Sandy? Oh, you can tell me. I've seen it a thousand times. It's written all over your face. You're gonna pass, ain't you, Cindy? Not that I blame you, girl. But you're gonna pass.
He was a marvelous, marvelous actor. I remember that I used the film High Yellow in Hollywood to get my agent. And my agent was so impressed with Bill that they called him and begged him to come to Hollywood. But Bill said, no, Dallas is my home and it's where I belong and where I'm staying. But you couldn't have met a better individual than Bill McGhee. And he helped me so much through that time. That was such a difficult time. I will always, 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 always remember that man.
Later, when we formed the Dallas Minority Repertory Theater, he was a great help. I also got a part in a play. I think it was at Granny's Dinner Theater, called God's Favorite. And I was playing Maidie the Maid, and Bill was my husband in the play. So I really, all during rehearsals, you know, he was really, because I'm brand new at all of this still. He would show me just little tiny tips on things. Like, for instance, one time I remember I was making some coffee, and we didn't have any more of the little stir sticks. They were gone. He said, well, no, I'll show you how to do that. He said, okay, put your creamer and your sugar and everything in the cup first, and then just pour the coffee over and swish it as you go. And by the time you get through, it'll already be sweet and cream. You don't have to stir it. Just tiny things like that that probably seem insignificant, but they were such a show of friendship.
I loved your daddy with my whole heart and soul, and he was a great man.
Yeah, I remember him fondly, yes, yeah. It was just, I miss him.
And what Bill brought to the stage was a fantastic amount of energy and empathy and actor talent. I mean, Bill was talented. He wasn't just there for his, Bill was really driven by, I think, just what drives a lot of us. We have something in us that needs an expression. And it was real talent in his case. He spoke, he had a fabulous speaking voice. It was not dramatized in some phony kind of way. It was very authentic to who he was. He sounded like a real person. He looked like a real person. And but he had the ability to immerse himself into a character.
I have definitely forgotten that salt.
Woman, We are in what looks like Ku Klux country, with hordes of hawkers staring at me like hungry dogs waiting for a bone, and you worrying about salt?
Baby, now you're a doctor and you have your practice, and the whole world hangs on the wisdom of your words. But you're still chicken shit.
Who was there with you in the hotel that night?
No one.
All holed up by yourself, huh?
Yes, sir.
Just reading the magazine, playing the radio.
Yes, sir.
Had the radio down real low, huh?
Yes, sir. That's right.
Now, what were you and your wife having all this trouble about?
Object, immaterial, and irrelevant. That would be his own personal business and not Mr. Atkins.
They've gone into it, Your Honor.
Answer it.
Sir?
Answer it.
Well, it was about a telephone call from a lady friend.
I had a phone call from your girlfriend, huh?
Yes, sir. I mean, no. I didn't get the phone call. My wife answered the phone, and that's when the argument really started.
Chautauqua, you know. Yes, our family goes there every summer. I don't like Chautauqua. Too many old people who sleep all the time. Uncle F.O.'s place isn't like that, is it?
Well, you know how health spas are. You can't get away from a certain degree of the relaxed life, but there's a good deal of action there, too.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I thank the Lord that you all could come today. What can we do for you in the house of the Lord?
And hold on to that really very appealing persona. Then the first show that I was given to direct was Pearlie, which was by a play, a comedy by Ossie Davis. We not only leaned on Bill to play Pearlie, but to help us find other actors who could play the other black roles in the show. Since he knew the community from his other experience, I'm sure that most of the people we recruited into that production were people that Bill brought with him. Then when we decided to Eugene O'Neill's The Emperor Jones, we decided that because Bill was available. It's an extremely demanding part. He's on stage from the beginning. It's a long one act. And he begins in the throne room with this island nation turning against him, falling apart. Then he fights his way through the jungle where various apparitions appear.
I'm also very proud to represent and introduce the film Don't Look in the Basement that was written by my father, Tim Pope. In remembering Bill, I've put together some thoughts about the great impact that he had on my family growing up in Fort Worth, Texas, and I'd like to share those with you today. Let me say that it was because of the film Don't Look in the Basement that I grew up feeling close to Bill McGhee. Though I did not have the privilege to meet him face to face until 5 years ago, when I invited him as a surprise guest to my father and daughter's co-birthday celebration. Growing up in Fort Worth, Texas, in the age of pre-internet, pre-email, and pre-instant media access, I grew to know Bill in the best way possible, through the voice of my father. And though Dad was not one to share much of his personal feelings, we were glad when he chose to share freely about Bill McGhee.
Oh, it's true. Dr. Stevens tells me what he wants.
Sam.
He's very sad this morning.
Why is he sad, Sam?
Because everything's changed now. Like that Miss Charlotte, and there's some others.
My baby's very sleepy. Very sleepy. Charlotte's name is Miss Beale. That's what you're supposed to call her.
Dr. Stevens calls her Miss Charlotte. He's very worried this morning.
Oh, hush it up, Sam. Leave us alone.
Bill, or Sam as we knew him, was a welcome haven in our conversations to which we could all retreat. Looking back, I'm not sure exactly how Dad introduced the racy subject material Don't Look in the Basement to his three young children. I do know that he left out all that was not suitable, yet still managed to offer an abundance of rich material for our young minds to play. And always, always, Bill McGhee is Sam. I am left to conclude then that most of our young memories of Don't Look in the Basement, as my father shared it with us, were based on a singular portrayal of Sam. Now as an adult, I understand that Dad spoke of him, not only because he liked him as a character, but because he related to him as a person, and because mostly he had become a friend.
Find the keys, and the downstairs windows are barred.
I'll show you.
In the trials of the day, Dad, the classic lone wolf artist, sought by many but responsive to few, held up Sam as a beacon of decency, the redeeming bright spot of humanity that illuminated the best of any creative endeavor. In Dad's mind, he was a true friend, someone who would have shared his own values. And so for us children, he was this also. If the Buddhists are correct that the only real way to experience another is through our mind and perceptions, then truly we knew Bill McGhee as well as any person, although we'd never met him, for in his spirit he shared our table with us at dinners and lived and breathed in my father's shop. And so when I tell you that the moment I met Bill McGhee was larger than life, you will know that I am not exaggerating. When Dad and Bill first stood face to face, it was a true homecoming. And in one blissful afternoon, we caught up on a lifetime of relating to one another, never having met in person, yet as familiar to one another as a favorite pair of shoes. It was also no surprise then, on that day of our meeting, to hear Dad tell Bill that he had him in mind all along as he wrote the character of Sam. I'm just eternally glad that Bill McGhee has been part of my life and part of my family's life. I feel he's enriched my life greatly. I think one of the most beautiful things that I have experienced is to watch my daughter, who met Bill, remember him often. She met him once in an afternoon, and she still, many, many, many times during the month and the year, will bring his name up and will say, Mom, I really love that man, Bill McGhee.
I don't know what more you can want from your work except a sense of joy. And to me, that's what Bill brought to the stage, a real sense of joy of doing something he was really good at and really special doing.